All right. There, Summer. I swear I let me. There's Daphne. We're only missing I. Richard. We're missing two. All right. We're only missing two, so let's get started. Hang on, somebody's writing in the chat. Oh, look, there's my friend Eric. Down to one. Somebody's just was wondering if we were going to be using our hackathon rooms, which we aren't, and they need code from their partner. Xander, do you need their email? Do you want to send me who your partner was and I can send you their email, or we can work on that? Just let me know. All righty. So what we have today is our warm-up on Canvas. It's very simple. We're doing U7 L2 parameters and returns investigate, everyone's favorite. What is due today is basically just the warm-up. U5 L13 to 17, the hackathon is due on Wednesday. U7 L3 parameters and returns practice is going to be due next class, and that will be our homework between now and then, all right? So our objective or goal is that you will be able to investigate programming patterns using parameters and returns by understanding how two apps work on code.org. So somebody else is asking, what if your partner isn't working with you and you email, but they're not answering? Can you send me an email and I will forward it and you know who your partner is and I will make a formal demand? Okay. Good to see that you guys do have problems and that there's things I can help with. So if you are not finding your partner in your room responsive, just let me know who that partner is and I can figure out their email and I will request your code or your screens. I know I had one person that was having issues. They were trying to import screens with screen, you know, add a screen to their thing. The issue is you can only do a clean import of your user interfaces. Everything has to be out except for the blank screen in order for the import to work. All right. We're done with the hackathon. Hackathon ended in terms of breakout rooms two classes ago. So I cannot recreate the hackathon breakout rooms and I cannot put people back in. We are on to new and different things. If you're having issues, just let me know and I will try and prompt your partners. So I am sorry that this period four seems to be having more issues than anyone. So don't worry, we will get this straightened out. It's a team thing and you know that sometimes things don't work out quite right, particularly with like the groups of three and four. I do think everyone has learned a lot as a result of trying to work with partners. It's just a very different experience than doing it all by yourself. All right, so that is that. I'm going to stop sharing and we're going to look at our warm-up. I show the answers, so that's why I am stopping sharing. Okay, let me do one thing before we do this, just for grins.
I mean, I'll just try asking this, but if there's a lot of people that aren't on the same page as their partners, why would there be an inability to have like a 5-minute breakout room at the end or something?
I do not have the breakout rooms anymore. If you want to work with your partners on the hackathon, you're supposed to get their phone numbers, their emails, whatever, and you're supposed to learn how to work with your partners. Part of the problem of the hackathon is you are dependent on your partners and stuff, and they need to respond to you. I apologize if that is not happening, but I can't stop this class just because you haven't been able to make your breakout room work. Guys, nobody turns on their mics. Nobody talks to each other in breakout rooms. That is not my problem. I tell everyone, I turn on sharing. I tell you to share your emails. I tell you that you need contacts. You need people that you can call. You are supposed to ask 3 other people other than me before you ask me any question. So I am doing my best to provide you any and all opportunities to get the work you need done. But you have to take responsibility for your own actions in your room. If you are left high and dry, please reach out to me and I will make sure that we get this resolved. But I can't control what's going on in the breakout rooms. I go in there, I tell people to talk, I turn on the sharing. Part of the fun and learning is trying to figure out how to work with other people. It is not easy. It is a life skill that you will need for the rest of your life, how to get people that aren't particularly cooperative or responsive to do what you need. So I understand. Everyone is trying their hardest and you're frustrated and you're trying to get these in. Let me know how I can help you and how I can make those contacts, because I do think if I contact someone on your behalf, hopefully they will respond. As I have learned, there is no guarantee of that, okay? So all I'm trying to show here is where the warm-up is and the idea that down here for the practice, if you look in here, there's no worksheet. I'm just gonna look in your code.org. These are what you're supposed to do in the different levels. This is the playlist of the videos. These are the videos that solve each level, okay? All righty, so let's do our warm-up. I'm gonna stop. And again, I am very sorry and it hurts me that your partners are not cooperating as well as they should. But I do think, for one, learning how to work with other people in terms of coding and apps is just good experience. No, it's not the easiest and it's easier to do it all yourself, but you gotta learn. And you know, it's not gonna kill you. I will make sure that everyone survives this, all right? So first question, what is a parameter, okay? Is it an extra piece of information passed to a function to customize it for a specific need, 2 stressed and unstressed syllabic patterns in a verse or within the lines of a poem, 2 meters in length or 2.18723 yards, a way to tell if a function worked or not? Rebecca says, an extra piece of info. Yes. All right. Anybody else have a feeling on that? What is the parameter? Is it A, B, C, or D? We have 1 vote for an extra piece of info. Let's get at least 1 more vote in there. Anybody? Extra piece of info. Okay, so it is an extra piece of information passed to a function to customize it for a specific need. It is not 2 stressed and unstressed syllabic patterns in a verse within the lines of a poem. Yes, sometimes we get a little desperate for alternate questions. Okay, next one's very easy. There is a limit on the number of parameters you can define for a function. Is that true or false? There is a limit on the number of parameters you can define for a function. Everybody's on board. It is false. Apparently, you can define as many parameters as you would like for your function, but at this stage in the game, I would keep it to fewer than more. Okay, that is a great accomplishment. Thank you. Let's get back to where we need to be. All right. Here we go. So we are looking at Unit 7, Lesson 2. Okay, if everyone can go to Unit 7, Lesson 2 in their code.org, parameters and return investigate, that would be fabulous. Are clean and organized programs more useful for computers or people, and why? Try and give examples from programs you've written or seen in this class. Can anyone put a thought in the chat on are clean and organized programs more useful for computers or people? And a little thought of why. I'll give you a minute. Are clean and organized programs more useful for computers or people? Why is that? No one seems, oh, look, there's one. People, since computers will run the function or code anyway, even if it's disorganized. Organized code is to help the coder find where each segment of code is and where similar code may be. Fabulous answer. People, computer can run it even if it's all jumbled. People, because they are the ones trying to interpret what is going on in the code. Brilliant. Those are all great ideas. The idea is, yes, a computer just runs a program top to bottom. It could care less. It has no, it is Mr. Spock. It just does what's logical. We benefit from having code that is clean and commented and that we can easily understand where everything is. The idea that you're declaring your variables up top and you're creating your functions down below, that just helps you know, oh, where do I look? Computer doesn't care where the function is. All right, so clean programs may sometimes run better, but usually they're just helpful for us as we read them and write them. In other words, clean code is for people, but in the long run, writing good code can help us write larger and more complicated programs because we can just read them and understand what they're doing. Today, we're going to learn about parameters and return values. Something important to notice is that they might not actually change the way that your program runs, but they definitely will change the way we read and write the programs. In general, they'll make programs cleaner and easier to understand. Let's go look at some examples. All right, we are into the activity. I felt a little bad last time that we were rushed at the end and we didn't get through that last breakout room. So I just want to make sure parameters, arguments, returns are all making sense to you. Functions with parameters and return values help us simplify our code. Functions can only return one value at a time. A function can have no parameters and no return values, parameters and no return values and no parameters, parameters and return values, any combination of those. So what we're looking at here on the right, this is make a cake, right? So make cake is our function and it has two parameters, tiers and flavor, right? Our arguments are what go in those parameters. How many tiers? What flavored cake? Those are the arguments that go in the parameters. Then down below is the recipe. That is inside the envelope, remember? This is how the parameters are used. So we have our make cake, it has tiers and flavor. If we evaluate that, as we did for our program, that I want three tiers and I want a lemon cake, Then the program runs different segments. So this is a loop, right? Repeat tiers, however many tiers I need, three times. So I am going to make one tier. It is lemon flavored. I bake a lemon flavored tier and ice it. Then I go back. I create another tier that is lemon flavored and I ice it. And I come back and I create another layer that is lemon flavored and I ice it. And now I have three tiers and three is not greater than three. So I stop my loop. Now I assemble my tiers into one cake. One, two, three. Boom, we're done. Okay. I couldn't create ones for the house. I should have, I was rushed. But I was worried about our house and some ways that you were being asked to work with it, which we never quite got to. One, I should have modeled how to draw your house once you get those parameters, you know, the arguments for the parameter. So if this was my build house function, instead of make cake, it was build house. I decided that my house was only going to have two parameters, windows and door. Okay. And so instead of tiers, I had windows. Instead of flavor, I have doors. I wanted four windows and one door. All right. So windows gets four, doors gets one. When we come down to the formula, it's going to be, you know, make a door or make a window four times so that I have four windows and then, you know, make a door. Okay. If I was my friend's partner and I needed to show how that looks, okay, on that graph paper, and this is a thing for last class, you do not need to turn in the activity guide. That just has the graph paper, and I don't think anyone really got to that. You can just turn in the slides. That's fine. On my graph paper, if this is just my graph, hang on, So if this was my graph paper, if I just had a square, all I'm doing, I am being asked to make one window. I'm sorry, it doesn't look very good. A window is just a square. Then I make another window. My pen is running out of ink. Then I make another window, and then I make another window. Oh, this is really annoying. Oh, and now my pen just broke. This is basically all my drawing would end up looking like. It's the idea that I drew one, two, three, four windows and one door. My house is not three-dimensional. I cannot put them anywhere else, okay? So then we got to the evaluating part, right? So we're here, this is a recipe for the cost of a cake, right? I have three tiers. Each tier costs $5 if it's chocolate, $4 if it's lemon, $3 if it's vanilla. So all I'm doing is I am multiplying three flavor cost multiplied by the number of tiers, right? I'm making a lemon cake, flavor cost is four. My number of tiers is three. My cake evaluates to $12. 12 is what my return is, okay? If we were back in our house and I had build house, doors, window and door, I would have five windows, let's say at $5 a piece, that would be $20. One door at $10 a piece, and that would be 30 for my house, right? I had four windows, one door. So my house would evaluate to $30, okay? I just wanted to make sure we understood that piece before we moved on. Is everyone okay on that? Okay, first thing we're gonna do, And I hate to say it, it's going to be in random breakouts. I just don't have the hackathon breakouts. In breakout rooms, navigate to level 2. Read the program with your group. Respond to all questions for your app. I tell you what, it just occurs to me. I've been getting done early with this lecture. If I'm done early, let me see if I can just create a custom breakout room for you, okay? For anyone who needs to talk to their partners for the hackathon, all right? So what you're gonna do, you're gonna be looking at the number cruncher. Respond to all the questions for your app. Be ready to share your responses and what you learned with the class. This is the idea of unmute and actually talk in your breakout room. So we've got the number cruncher for 5 minutes, all right? We're gonna be discussing how does the calculate symbol work? What is the parameter? What is the argument? What is returned here, okay? Those are gonna be the questions. Then we'll also, you can also take a moment to look at lines 30 to 36. How does the mod operator, the percent symbol, work? Answers mod 2. It's a percent symbol here. We will talk about that, all right? Here we go, let me make my rooms. I'm gonna go with, well, it says they're rooms of 3. All right, perfect. Okay, we are at 204. We will come back at about 209, 210, all right? Go in, try and figure out what is going on here.
Mrs. Swift, I had one more thing to tell you.
Sure.
The U5L10 thing, I thought we were supposed to do that with a partner and then they turn it in, or were we supposed to both turn in the discussion?
Everybody got the points on U5L10. What's happening is that it's being combined with U5L7. So you get 5 points for the discussion and 5 points if you got L7 right, or did L7, period.
Oh, okay. All right, thank you.
I'm sorry, it's confusing. Kareem, go to your breakout room. Okay, everyone will be back in a moment. Where is my chat? Okay. Okay. Does somebody want to try and explain what's going on here to us? What's happening in these first 14 lines? Okay. Anyone? How about my friend Lily Kreindler? Can you tell me what's going on with the start of this app?
One second.
Oh, here, hang on. Let me share. I'm going to share. I've got my code.org open.
Okay. My internet's being a little laggy. So one second.
Perfect. So here, if we're just looking at the first 14 lines or what? They're mostly on events.
It's making the buttons work and it's showing like what it's supposed to calculate.
Okay. So it's going to calculate and it's going to multiply or it's going to subtract or it's going to add. Right? And then, hang on, let me just see, are we supposed to be going? Okay, so how does the calculate symbol work there? And what are the parameters and argument and return? Lily, I'm gonna stick with you because you're so fabulous.
Okay,
So what are the parameters here? Are the parameters in these on events or are they in the function?
They're in the function, I think.
Right. Parameters are always going to be in the function. So here is our function calculate. There's only one thing with it. So we only have one parameter and that is symbol. Okay.
Okay.
So, and that's what we're getting there. So then, you know, how does it work with what we're doing?
It's just calculating the, like what you put in based off what symbol you choose.
Right, and you're just dropping number one and number two on either side of the math operator and executing the operation, right? But then it's this idea of, hang on, I'll show you, this is our favorite question. Take a moment, look at lines 30 to 36. How does the mod operator work? Okay, so if I'm looking here, this thing, how does, get everybody out of the way. We're not blocking stuff on my screen. What is this percentage doing here? When it says answer mod two, or answer percentage sign two. We are calling that percentage sign a mod. Can anyone tell me what happens here?
Well, yeah, it's basically looking whether or not like the answer is a part of like the mod of two, and therefore looking if it's divisible by two, and therefore giving you, in this case, if it's basically saying if the answer is divisible by two, because it has no rest, no remainder.
And if it's not, it'll be an odd number. Okay, all the mod symbol, the percentage sign is doing, it is a way of saying divided by. So it is answer divided by two. Answer mod two. Let's go into this because mods are a little strange. And I have difficulty with them myself. Okay, so take a moment to look at lines 30 to 36. How does the mod operator work? The mod operator divided by divides two numbers and returns the remainder. The remainder is the mod, okay? In this case, if a number divided by two has a remainder of zero, it is an even number. Hang on, we've lost Olivia. All right. So if it has a remainder, it is an odd number. All right. So here's how mods work. With regular math, you add 3 and 2, you get 5. You subtract 2 from 3, you get 1. You multiply 3 times 2, you get 6. Divide 3 by 2, you get 1.5. With the mod is the remainder. So when I say 3 mod 2, that is how I would describe 3 percentage sign 2. In JavaScript, the percentage sign will be referred to as mod. So 3 mod 2 is 3 divided by 2, and that's gonna leave us with 1 as the remainder, right? It goes in once and then there's a remainder of 1. That means it will be mod 1, okay? Mod is just the remainder, okay? Mod is the remainder that is left after a number is divided by another number. Let's practice. Okay, 17 mod 5 would be what? You can sing out or put it in the chat. What would 17 mod 5 be? 17 divided by 5 is 3 with a remainder of what?
2.
Yay, Rebecca. So that would be mod 2, okay? 17 divided by 5 goes in 3 times, has a remainder of 2. Mod 2. Mod is what that percentage sign is called in Java. A common usage is to determine if a number is even or odd. If you divide any number by 2 and there is no remainder, the number is even. You can use mod to determine if a number is divisible by another number. Okay, how about 8 mod 5? Who can tell me what that is? Open up my
3.
That is correct, because 5 goes into 8 once with the left remainder of 3. Let's try. Oh, hang on, sorry, I get back in my screen. 27 mod 6. How about Daphne Gunas? Can you tell me what 27 mod 6 is? Daphne? How about Allie Asher? Allie, could you tell me what 27 mod 6 is?
3,
correct. So 6 goes into 24 4 times, remainder of 3, it's mod 3. Okay, here's a different one. This is just a different notation. Jordan Lane, what would 42 mod 3 be? It's a bit of a trick question. Jordan, what do you think 42 mod 3 would be? Okay, how about Madeline Bell? Madeline, I'm gonna pick on you. What would 42 mod 3 be? So it's 42 divided by 3. Is there a remainder is the question. Madeline? Oh, there we go. Hang on, there's Jordan. I've got her. It's not 14 is how many times 3 goes into 42, correct. But what would that make us in mod? It would be mod 0 because it goes in evenly. There is no mod. Perfect, great job, Jordan. All right, I think we are getting these, all right? I don't wanna spend too much time on this. 3 mod 15, what happens when the second number is bigger than the first number? You cannot divide 3 by 15, so it is just mod 3. Whatever the original number one is becomes the mod. So 100 divided by 7 is gonna be 98. So that's gonna be mod 2. 8 mod 54 is just gonna be mod 8 because 54 cannot go into 8. All right, mod can be a little tricky. Oh, hang on, all right. Can be a little tricky, but here's what you need to remember, all right? It's the remainder that is left after a number is divided by another number. It's just the remainder. Why is this useful? A common usage is to determine if a number is even or odd. If you divide any number by 2 and there is no remainder, the number is even. You can also use mod to determine if a number is divisible by another number, okay? All right, we are gonna go look at a new app. This is the word game helper with your breakout room group. Navigate to level 3. You are gonna read lines 1-14. What is happening there? Be prepared to discuss with the class. All right, so this is the word game helper. All right, we're gonna spend 4 minutes in fabulous breakout rooms. Okay, here we go. We'll come out at about 2:24. You're just looking at the first 14 lines and trying to see what is happening. Be prepared to discuss. Okay, Nikolai, Eric, Andrew, Liv. Nikolai, Eric. Eric. Okay, everyone is back. I am just looking for someone to share with me what these first 14 lines are. What's going on here? How about my friend Viraj? Viraj Singh, can you explain what your group saw in the first 14 lines? Viraj, you out there? Okay. How about Anjali George?
It's Anjali.
Anjali, thank you. Nothing I like better than getting things right.
Should I explain like what we talked about?
Sure. What did you talk about? And I'm ideally showing it on the screen. So we've got this word list. You've got a filtered word list and what looks like some on events.
We said that when the user inputs like a number and a letter from the dropdowns, the code like filters through the word list to like give you your outputs, which is whatever words fit that category.
Okay. And so all that's happening here, you've got the length dropdown, you've got the letter dropdown. Those are our two dropdowns. You've got get number from the length. All right. So now we're gonna go back and we're gonna look at the next part, which is, okay, for 5 minutes, we're gonna go in and you're gonna look at lines 15 through 34 carefully. After you are done, explain to your group how the function works, what parameter it takes and what is returned. Next, if you have extra time, complete the modify. We're just gonna discuss in class, how does the word game helper work? And that's the last breakout room that we're doing, okay? So we've got 5 minutes. Let's come back at 2:31. Alex, Ethan? Rogel? Okay, we are back. Does somebody want to volunteer to explain what they were seeing, or shall I pick someone? I'm going to get my fabulous spinner up and working, I swear. How about Emily Yanez? Emily, is that the right way to pronounce your name?
Amelie.
Amelie?
Yeah.
Okay. So what did your team feel was going on in 14 through 34? First off, what are the parameters? Amelie?
Like, you can pick. So
filter is our function. So what are the parameters? It's just these two guys inside the parentheses. Len, yeah, and letter.
Yeah.
Those are our two parameters, and they're going to be evaluated with the arguments that, you know, we're putting in here, that I want length to be 3. I want length to be 7. I want the letter to be A. Those are our arguments, are the numbers that we're creating in the dropdown. Okay, and how was it working? Amelie?
Like, depending on what you pick, it gets like the data from like, I don't know how to explain it.
That's all right. No, you were doing a great job. So it's the idea that, you know, if it says I want 3, we're going to get all the 3-lettered words starting in A. So it's going to check the list for words starting in A, and then it's going to check for the length. You know, is it 3? And if it is, it's going to filter them. You're going to append the items to the filtered word list, okay? So it's going to go all the way through. It's using filtered word list.length. Append items, filtered word list, word listed I, all that good stuff. It's a silly thing that I was asking, what is waiting image and unclickable? Any idea? Anyone? I don't think we ever see unclickable, but the waiting image is just this hourglass over here. Okay, that's all that is. Okay, so now hopefully I can solve a bunch of problems. Hang on. So we are done with this unit. Let's get our takeaways. Extracting shared features to generalize functionality is known as procedural functional abstraction. It's known as procedural or functional abstraction. Using parameters allows the functions, also called procedures, to be generalized. Using procedural abstractions helps improve code readability. Procedural abstractions manage complexity by allowing for code reuse. So this is the idea when you have a function and then parameters. There's a lot of arguments that can go in those parameters. It's a relatively general function, right? That's the beauty of them. Procedural abstraction manages complexity by allowing for code reuse. For example, the function move parentheses ID comma direction end parentheses could be used to move an element in any direction rather than writing separate functions for each direction, okay? Now we are into our practice, right? You've seen the practice. What is one way you think programming with parameters in return may make programming and debugging more challenging? You're thinking about debugging. You're going to be using your console log to call functions with parameters and see how calling them with different values returns different values. Use the speed slider to slow down your code and watch the function. That's it. You guys are just going to be doing the practice. Remember all the, you know, Kirk Kaiser videos are in that assignment on in our module. Okay, we have 4 minutes left. Who wanted to get into a breakout room with their team for the hackathon? I just need names and I'll create breakout rooms. Okay, anyone? So Xander and Richard, all right, let's. Okay, sorry. Why is that not? Xander and Richard. So I've got Xander and Richard. Anybody else? Somebody desperately wanted a room. All right, well here, I'll open up that one for Xander and Richard. Anybody else want a breakout room? Guys, I'm so sorry. I did not mean to intimidate you. I can create a breakout room now for you, but you're not asking me. Nobody needs a breakout room to talk about their hackathon or exchange their code. All you're doing to exchange code is making a copy of your code in text and sending it to your partner to copy into theirs. You could also just share your app with them. If you just hit the share button and send them the link, they can remix it and get the code themselves. Somebody did have issues with a sharing setting. If you do, let me know. Nobody else needs a room? Okay, we are almost out of time. I will let everyone go in a moment. I just wanted to say thank you very much for being as kind and as patient. Oh yes, no, Lily, I've got someone working on that for you. I'm sorry, I haven't heard back yet.
Okay, no, thank you. I just was checking.
No, we're trying. Okay, everyone can go. Thank you so much. And I know as we're trying to get this transition back in the building, it's just stressful on everyone. So I apologize for being overstressed.
Thank you, Mr. Swift.
Thank you, Mr. Swift. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Look, there's a new someone. Who is that? Masked man.
Hi, Mr. Swift.
Bye.
Hi. I had a quick question about my code.org.
Sure. I've got somebody coming in a heartbeat, but let's figure it out. What's weird is you've been in my class the whole time. You should.
I know.
But I feel like, are there two accounts?
I remember creating an account with my school account And then allegedly I forgot my password. So I created a new account with my personal email. Do you think that the problem's that it's not the MCPS email?
That's exactly what it's, that's, you're working on your personal account, not your school. Right. Okay. So the good news is, hang on 2 seconds. We can do this.
Cool.
All right. And we can do it really quick, I believe.
I'm in code.org right now.
Okay. I don't think it's anything to do with you. I think it's just going to be a question of what you want your new password to be. Because I can change the password on your school code.org
account. Oh, that'd be wonderful.
I figured as much. And again, just so sorry. Everything is so weird and confusing when it's not working.
That's on my end. It was a mistake.
I didn't. Well, but again, I never want to be impugning your integrity, but I can only see.
I understand that you have to verify. Yeah. Yeah. I understand.
And I used to be good at this as a student too. Creative ways of making things work. Now, why aren't
That's right. But yeah, that first email I sent to you with the attachment with no name, there was no way to verify that that was me. So it was a bit sketchy.
Just good to know that at least I was right there. Hang on. So I'm going in here. Come on. I'm going to manage my students. And in theory, my friend Nikolai Forrest,
we're going
to reset your password to what? What would you like?
Let's do capital L. Love me, 0011.
Love me, jeez, guys. Who are you worried is getting into your stuff?
Hang on, it's easy to remember, though.
Love me, 0011.
Love me, 0011.
Okay.
And then my username is what? Nikolai7172.
That's what your username is. I can change that too. It doesn't bother me.
That's fine. We can keep that. Okay. So I'm gonna log in with the new. So you've updated as of right now.
Yes, you should be good.
Love me 0011 Nikolai7172.
Correct.
Okay, so I'm gonna complete the. I think 11.3 is what you assigned. I'm gonna complete that on this account.
Yes, that would be great. That would be great because then I'll be able to see it. Etc. And like I say, if you're feeling comfortable, I got no problem with you just doing the last two circles of the app. If you're not, going through it all really helps to cement those ideas.
I'll do that. It's not 11.3, it's 7.1. So I'll submit that with the new credentials.
Okay, well, you're going to have 7.3 too. That's coming up as your practice. So the good news is we're all on the same page.
Awesome. Thanks for your help.
No, my pleasure. So good to see you.
Yeah.
Nobody looks like what I expect.
Yeah. All right. Take care.
Xander, Richard, are you there? Xander.
Yeah, we just we finished what we needed to do. Okay. I was just waiting to say thank you and goodbye.
Oh, you guys are so kind. That's way, way too polite. You could have run away. Thank you. You're both an asset to my program.
Thanks. Have a good day.
You bet. I will.
Bye.
Okay, guys.